Separated from home by 3,000 miles of sea, the fishermen of Portugal harvest a crop of vital need. On ancient fishing grounds discovered by their ancestors centuries before them, they struggle for 6 months of each year, leading lives of unbearable hardship, from which some will never return. A frail partnership against the unrelenting fury of an Arctic sea. Dwarfed by the enormity of their opponent, they wait to be blinded by fog, tossed by waves that will tower 30 feet high. The last to carry on this heroic tradition, theirs is the battle of the lonely Dorymen. They, the living legends, Portugal's men of the sea. Set sail to the large wind. Heaven is our guide, and God our course directs. By sea, how many storms, how many harms, death in how many several fashions dressed. On a manuscript retrieved from shipwreck in 1559, these thoughts of the Portuguese mariner echo still in the modern harbor of Lisbon. For centuries, the sea has been their livelihood, and to it that gives them life, the Portuguese offer their lives in return. Times will change, but the sea will not. Today, a century ago, the departure of the Portuguese fishing fleet to be gone for 6 months of the year is marked by a period of mourning, as though it was never to return. From small hamlets and seacoast villages, the young men gather, bringing with them one bundle of clothes, one satchel of bedding, and a family who will wait on the wharves till their ships can no longer be seen. 3,000 men for 33 ships. Men who since their youth have never spent a summer at home, have rarely been with their wives during the birth of their children. Sail, the four-masted schooner José Alberto lays a course northwest to the Grand Banks of Newfoundland, a course said to have been traveled by the Portuguese since a time even before Columbus sailed the same route in search of a new land. Even in the year 1440, when they braved the Atlantic in ships made of wood, the Portuguese were masters of the sea. They opened trade routes to India and the Far East, developed the early science of navigation, and passed on to their sons inheritance of the sea itself. Captain Abreu da Silva, Taking his first command as captain of a fishing vessel, charts his course with sextant and sun. The first test of his skill, a job of navigating through unpredictable weather for the first 2,000 miles of his journey. In 12 days, it will take him from Lisbon to the Grand Banks off the coast of Newfoundland. Here he will fish, then set sail due north into the angry currents of Arctic water. On the ship, there will be relative safety. But each man must brave the ocean alone. The vessel to which he entrusts his life, the dory, is made of wooden plank, just 16 feet long. For each man, one dory, chosen by the drawing of lots, a process filled with superstition. Some numbers are considered bad luck, some good. On the basis of previous campaigns, the men hope to draw numbers that have brought many fish in the past, and pray not to draw one that went beneath the sea with a friend.
Como é Francisco Marques da Rosa? 11. Como é Francisco Marques da Rosa? 11. 11.
For 51-year-old João Barreiro, a veteran of 26 campaigns, one number is much like the next. The oldest man aboard the José Alberto, his years of experience bring the simple hope that, whatever his number, it will be spared for another year. The mothership is a seagoing dormitory, but the dory itself is home. In the 12-day journey to Newfoundland, it must be made as seaworthy as possible, each man's skill accounting for his own safety in the water. The air ringing with the sound of hammer and nail, they prepare blocks for the anchor, bailers for the overflow, plugs to drain the water out after each day's fishing, and corking to keep it from seeping back in the next. A storehouse of equipment. On board are 100 dozen oarlocks, a half ton of lead for sinkers, 1,000 swivels for hand lines. Separating the endless chain of tangled fishing cord, each man will take 1 mile of it for his own, fishing with up to 1,000 hooks at a time. Among the first to fish the North Atlantic in a single dory with a simple hand line, today these fishermen are the last, clinging obstinately out of respect for tradition to a method of fishing and a dangerous way of life thought obsolete by the fishermen of other countries. Strangely, in time of storm, the men feel safer in their small dories than they do on the massive hull of the mothership. Alone on the ocean, their fate seems more personal. On the dory, they can bail, row, fight with their own hands. But on the mothership, all they can do is wait. New captain, the first turbulence serves as a reminder of headlines of legendary tragedy. All dories washed overboard. 100 men lost in a single night. 12 ships of the fleet sunk in a 10-day storm. passed the first test of his ability, Captain Silva's real test is yet to come. On his shoulders alone rests the responsibility of finding fish, codfish, the elusive and precious cargo which he and his men must take to capacity before they can think of returning home. Electronic fish finders tell part of the story, but a good captain relies on instinct, a feel, a smell, a flurry in the water that betrays the annual migration of millions of cod through these currents each year. Where they come from, where they go, no man is certain. But all aboard pray they will find them when they arrive. AM. First morning on the Grand Banks.
Louvado seja Cristo, são 4:30, meu almoço!
The hour to awaken is dictated by the first signs of fish. For 51-year-old Barreiro, a beginning like all others, aching muscles, and an abrupt end to the last full night's sleep any of them will have for the next 6 months. At sea, sunrise and sunset lose their meaning as the beginning and ending of the day. Here, the work ends only when the body is no longer able to continue. First ritual of the morning, preparation of the bait. Under careful scrutiny, each man is allowed only 12 mackerel to fish with during the day. It must be conserved from the beginning, or else by the end, the men will be fishing with no bait at all. More precious than any other commodity on board, the bait box is the only compartment closed with a lock and key. Next ritual, a cup of hot brandy. Given more liberally than the bait, here the men can return for second helpings, to help fortify themselves against the bitter spring wind of the Newfoundland waters. Captain Silva, who has been awake all night searching for fish, must be satisfied that this is just the right place and just the right moment to send his dories onto the sea. Traditionally, the men must wait for his signal before making a move. The signal is Va con Deus. God be with you.
Estão prontos, vamos arriar com Deus. Vai arriar com Deus. Tira a prova, tira a ré.
The true beginning of the campaign. The maiden launching of the dories is mixed with anxiety and celebration. As if to assuage the temperament of the sea, they welcome it as a friend. The first hazard comes early. The very act of getting a dory away from the mothership can be dangerous. In even moderate waves, it is not uncommon that her 700 tons of heaving bulk will swamp or crush a dory that slips too close to her side. Like bees leaving a hive, each dory sets out on its own course. Though the captain has tried to locate his ship directly on top of a school of fish, superstition prohibits the dorymen from fishing there. Masters of their own vessels now, they will row anywhere from 1 to 10 miles away, seeking their own secret place of rendezvous with the fish. Out of the ship's sight, and away from all other dories, the trap is baited. A tedious process. More than 2 hours will pass before the last of some thousand hooks slips over the side into the depths of the near-freezing water. Drawn by unseen currents, many lines will tangle and break, leaving their owners with nothing to show for 12 hours of back-breaking work. First lunch, fresh bread and fried codfish. In the months to come, the dorymen will eat so much codfish, they will even be tempted to eat their bait. Captain Silva, an agonizing wait, perhaps the most painful job of all. Warmed by midday sun, the José Alberto drifts in slumber, its deck boys unaffected by their captain's torment.
Alô, Ave Maria, Ave Maria.
By shortwave radio, he reaches miles across the water, making contact with another vessel in the fleet, the Gilles Jens. A ship of Navy personnel that stands by with medical facilities in case of emergency and acts as a traffic center for all shortwave communication. Traditionally, the seasoned captains of the vessels tell white lies about their success in catching fish. It is a game they play to bolster their confidence and relieve the tension of passing time. With captains of other ships listening in, newcomer Captain Silva makes his first unconvincing try at the game. But the tension is little relieved. Here, success can only be measured in the weight of fresh cod. But miles away, the mystery of the first day's catch is soon to be solved. On an unspoken signal, the lines are retrieved. And the cod are here. Cod on every hook, heavy in weight, rich in color. And to the men of Alberto, a welcome sight. Once located, the cod almost beg to be caught. Although respected for their value, they are called fool fish by the Portuguese. For once they are hooked, they never attempt to shake free. It is fortunate, for the value of cod runs high. In Lisbon, they will sell for 50 cents a pound, ironically making them too expensive for even the fishermen to eat once they return home. A skate means wasted bait. He will not be counted as a part of the catch. To the skilled fisherman, each hook has importance, and no part of his hard-earned prize can be allowed to slip away. The first to fill his dory and return to the ship gains great prestige. Even at a distance, each doryman can tell how well the other is doing. The more fish he takes, the lower his dory rides in the water. In high seas, the heavier the catch, the greater the danger of being swamped. But it is said that the dorymen would rather sink than throw away a single cod. For this sense of competition, a real reason. The men are paid on the basis of their catch. Some will be consistently good, taking in as much as a half ton a day. Others consistently bad, never once filling their dories to capacity. Regardless of their skill, all share one incentive in common. The ship cannot return home until it is full, its hold bulging with almost 1,000 tons of cod. Therefore, the greater each day's catch, the closer they all are to home. Climbing aboard with the assistance of the waves can prove an unpredictable entrance. A sudden gust of wind has been known to sweep men aboard still seated in their dories. But once safely on deck, another phase of work begins. After 12 hours of fishing, they must now clean and pack their catch. Forming an assembly line, each man is assigned a specific task. A throater, cutting three strokes from the throat, opens the fish to send it down the line. A liverer removes the liver and other valued parts. Then a splitter cuts the fish in two, sending it toward the bats. With all hands participating, an ocean-going factory, humming with the pride of a tremendous first day's success. 20,000 pounds of fresh cod, the omen of a good campaign. And below the factory, a sea-going salt mine. Due to lack of refrigeration, the fish are packed in layers of salt, losing more than half their weight as the salt drains them of water. The more they dry, the more that can fit in the hold. And as the days wear on, the captain will actually hope for rough seas to pack them tightly against each other and allow room for more still. This, the most crucial process. A fraction too much or too little salt will make the entire cargo worthless. The working day begins to wane. 12 hours of fishing, 6 hours of cleaning, only 6 hours left to eat and sleep. But tonight is a special night, and they will find time for just one more event. The birthday of João Varela, on this day 52 years of age. Had the day not been successful, it is likely that none would have celebrated.
San Pedro, que é pequeno, foi marinheiro no mar. Lançar a rede ao mar, lançar a rede ao mar, se tem confusão e medo. San Pedro, que é pequeno, foi marinheiro no mar. E agora já tem as chaves.
Fisherman João dos Santos Pareiro, residence Vila do Conde, born 1916. Likely he will continue with the fleet until he is no longer able. He could retire, but what then to do with his summers? Start to finish, the first day's fishing is steeped in tradition. In an atmosphere changing to quiet reverence, the first meal is served. It is called the soup of sorrows. Those that partake of it will be alive to return to the Grand Banks again next year. The serving that follows is fresh potatoes and boiled cod. Taxing the chef's skills, in the months to come, cod will be served in more than 100 different ways. The party continues. But in a few hours, they must all re-enter the sea. For Varero, the end of a happy day. The beginning of his 27th year as doryman for the José Alberto. The traditional first stop in Newfoundland can bring grief and frustration. In an instant, the gates of ice are closed, and all safely inside the harbor of St. John's must bide their time until the sea allows them to leave. Said to be the oldest settlement in North America, for one season each year, St. John's becomes a cosmopolitan port of call, entertaining the fishing fleets of 14 different nations as they stop for fresh bait, fresh food, and that most precious cargo of all, a shipment of mail from home.
Arnaldo Gomes Santos.
For the men of José Alberto, it is the first communication from loved ones since their departure from Lisbon. In the months at sea, many things at home will change. Children will be born, relatives will die, and quite often, love letters from the girl in Lisbon will be answered with a long-distance proposal of marriage. Days of waiting for the ice to break bring frustration. For wasted time means less fish and more days away from home. To pass the idle hours, some will visit a building called the Portuguese Center, established on St. John's in tribute to this fleet that has been stopping on its shores for so many centuries. Here, entertainment comes in many forms. There are books to read, people to meet, and perhaps some wages to be lost in friendly competition with fishermen from other countries. Others will pass the time in a continuing game of soccer, with teams of one ship competing with the next, sometimes supplementing their lineup with the eager children of St. John's. For most, there is one serious responsibility: visiting the graves of relatives and fellow fishermen who in years past came to St. John's to stay. Written in stone on this distant shore are the chronicles of entire family histories, the names of great-grandfathers, fathers, and sons, now resting side by side where their fleet first put them ashore. A breath of warm breeze has broken the ice, and all must make their escape. Beneath flags of France, Spain, Russia, and Sweden, each ship begins a new journey in search of the cod. For the men of the José Alberto, destination Arctic Circle. In search of better fishing, a course due north into the midnight sun. Captains will venture into Arctic waters. Unpredictable winds can instantaneously whip the water into a gale of ice crystals, and fog can descend like a smothering cloud, leaving dories lost at the very doorstep of home. Here there will be no night for 2 months, the fishermen losing track of time, working even longer hours in the near freezing temperature. Here too, fierce competition from the massive trawlers that cross and recross the shallow water, dragging up great quantities of the prize the dorymen fight so hard to take one at a time. Even beneath the surface, danger from whales that have been known to overturn dories with a slap of their tails. Such is the specter of the Greenland waters. But still, the Portuguese return. For over a decade, Barreiro has fished off Greenland shores, yet he has never set foot on it. It is a bad luck shore. The only ones who touch it are the sick and the dead. Those that come often reach the shores of Holsteinsborg, population 2,000. For the injured and ill, here there is a hospital. But for the Portuguese fishermen, a mystifying and frightening experience. He does not speak English. They do not speak Portuguese. He cannot tell them where it hurts. The doctor cannot tell him what is wrong.
Hello.
Do you speak English?
No, I speak English.
Not at all. Do you speak
compreendo o francês?
Não, francês.
Não, francês.
Só português.
Só. Estômago livre, grande. 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 E grande. Compreendo?
Compreendo. Grande.
Grande. Opkastninger. Opkastninger. Vomitus. Vomitus. Vomitus.
Não tem vomitus.
Tem lá. Dynamic.
Diagnosis by pantomime. Language barriers reducing the practice of medicine to a primitive form. Here, the emotional discomfort can grow as painful as the malady. By tone of voice alone, the doctor recognizes the question, what is to become of me?
Possible, Danimark, Copenhagen.
You will be flown to another hospital in Denmark. Do you understand? No, I do not understand. Strange food, strange language, and a pain he cannot describe. Frightening is the realization that in a 2-mile trip from sea to shore, he has left his own country and become stranded in a foreign land. Even on board the José Alberto can the strangeness of this country be felt. Shrouded by fog, life comes to a standstill. The exuberant voices of yesterday, today stilled to a whisper. Without warning, it descended. And if the temperament of Greenland is cruel, it might stay for days. Had they their way, many of the men would go out. But Captain Silva knows they would be lost. All there is to do is wait, frustrated over the unproductive hours, thinking always of more days away from home. The sea grows calmer. The fog seems to lift. In desperation, Silva gives the signal to fish. They know their captain is in doubt, but if they never fished when there was doubt, they would never fill their hold. Still, today is voluntary. Those who do not wish to enter the water will not be made to. For the first time, they go in groups, risking entanglement of lines for the safety in numbers. Should they become lost so close to the magnetic North Pole, their compasses will deceive them. And among their boats, there is not one life jacket, one rudder, or even an extra day's provision of food. The cod, too, seem to have turned against them. Half their bait lost in the first hour, they are left two alternatives: find the ship or row to a new spot. But the weather has decided for them. Broadcasts of squall warnings from the supply ship Gilles Jens force Captain Silva to call them back. The fog closing in again, their return must be instantaneous, or they might not make it back at all.
É costume.
Battling a conspiracy of elements, one by one, they appear from the mist. The current up to 5 knots, rowing is difficult, and diminishing visibility distorts the distance they must travel. On sound alone, each man finds home. And soon, all hands on the José Alberto are accounted for.
Alô, senhora da boa viagem, senhora da boa viagem, senhora da boa viagem.
A few miles away, Captain Ramallera of the São Rafael has not been so fortunate. All have returned but one, a young fisherman without experience, who probably rowed too far. By shortwave, all neighboring vessels are alerted to continue their signals and remain on the lookout. The absence of one man is felt by all, most deeply by his captain. It was his word that sent the man out. He will bear the burden of not being able to bring him back in. The dory can endure for days. The man cannot. If swamped, the dory will rise again to the surface. But in frigid water, the man will not. Searching the fog, each man sees an image of himself, rowing without direction to a ship that never appears. In such fog, even sound plays tricks, bouncing off invisible walls till its direction is incomprehensible. This time, luck prevails. The sea has granted a reprieve. The sight of the dory brings great relief, but all on deck are aware that before the voyage is over, some among them will have entered the fog, never to return. For straying so far in the fog, the young doryman will be disciplined. He might be made to stand on the deck for a period of hours. He might be prohibited from fishing the next day. An example only for the other men. His lesson has been learned. Having lived through a doryman's most feared experience with the sea, he knows he is fortunate just to be able to fear its happening again. The summer wind of Greenland begins to grow cold. Life continues for the doryman unchanged. An hour of the day, like a day in the year, loses its meaning in place and time. The second month might well be the fourth. The wind the same, the work the same, and the sea refusing to change. The only element beginning to alter is the man, growing weary as the months go on, performing his job in a state of semi-sleep. His hands opening with painful sea cuts that refuse to heal in the abrasive salt air. His feet becoming numbed by the cold. His mind slowing down in the absence of a setting sun. Still, the work goes on. One day merging with the next, the ship's hold never seeming to fill. No recall of the beginning. No foreseeable ending in sight.
Confiado
5 months, the men have slept 4 hours a night. The captain has slept just 2. For some, sleep came unwillingly. Sails go up in answer to a sudden wind, but the breeze that brings them greater mobility also brings their greatest problem. The prelude to Arctic winter, it will grow each day with a tempestuous rage, bringing squall, rain, and icebergs in its wake. Ready to leave or not, soon all must be out of its way. For it roars in like a steaming freight train, and there is little chance of surviving head-on collision. In the race against vanishing time, final tallies are made, double-checked and rechecked again. The José Alberto must carry home almost 1,000 tons of dried fish, 12 tons per man, or she will return in failure. But in the final tally, no disgrace. The end of 6 months' hard labor and a cargo to make any captain proud. Homeward bound. The sea that threatened has suddenly turned beautiful. The wind that was moments ago an enemy is suddenly a friend, filling her sails and pushing her on the long-awaited path toward home. Of a campaign is celebrated, but at the same time filled with nostalgia. For the situation that endangers life makes life cherished all the more. On into the evening they will talk of cod. The music they listen to is about the sea, and it is played on guitar strings made of fishing line. The cod that until now have merely been consumers of bait, fillers of dories, and cargo for the hold, will tonight become romanticized with the pride of having won them the hard way. A ship brimming full will bring wages averaging $1,000 for each man. In Portugal, enough to support a family until the next campaign. And as they look forward to reunion with loved ones, the image of the fisherman begins to change. In 6 months, many have not bathed, changed clothes, shaved, or had their hair cut. Till now, there has been no need. For 20 hours a day, all they have known is cod. Cod for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Boiled cod, poached cod, fried cod, broiled cod, cod steaks, cod fillets, cod tongues, cod cakes. Today, they have a taste of all. But tomorrow, there will be meat. Boots worn 3 sizes too big so they can be kicked off in an emergency are now shed for the last time. Roommates and bunk partners exchange addresses with the hope they will find themselves in the same company on the same ship when the fleet goes out again next year. Even now, as they prepare to sleep, on the shores of Lisbon, thousands of families await their arrival. Among them, some half dozen wait in vain. Those who do come back return not just from the sea, but from a journey into history. And on their lips is a prayer of thanks that it has delivered them safely back into modern times.
Thank you.
battle-scarred and weather-beaten, the fleet is a welcome sight. In its absence, many small villages in Portugal have been communities of women and children alone. This is the moment they've talked about, the tomorrow that seemed it would never come. Sons have grown taller, mothers grown older. Children have learned to speak their first words. A homecoming with all the exuberance of soldiers returning from battle. Husbands and wives must become reacquainted. Father and child reestablish their bond. What is worst about homecoming is that separation must begin again in just 6 months. But this is the legacy of Lisbon, a harbor wetted by waves and tears, witness to moans of sorrow and cries of joy as it maintains a permanent place in Portuguese history. Many generations have stood at these docks. These men, just a short time ago, young boys, waiting for their fathers to return from the sea. And so the process continues. Boys growing to men, men going to sea. For the 6 months they are home, the thoughts and the skills of the dorymen turn again to the sea. From scores of villages lining Portugal's seacoast, they return to the ocean each day, bringing back a saleable harvest of sardine. During these winter months, they call themselves the one-day fishermen of Portugal, taking the experience gathered on distant shores to match wits with this sea of their own. Using the time-honored method of hand net and oxen, they again choose a rugged way of life. But here, a man's labor is rewarded with his return home each night. Here, too, the day's work is exuberantly shared by everyone in the town, wives, family, lifelong friends. But the respite will end too soon, for even now as they gather their nets, miles away in the harbor of Lisbon, the great white fleet is being painted, repaired, refitted for its next campaign. Soon again, husbands and wives must part to await the end of the long summer alone. To them, it is accepted as a way of life, for life is synonymous with the sea. It is their home, their heritage, a host who has sustained them for as long as they have inhabited its shores. It is the very breath of Portugal and her indomitable men of the sea.